to invite me to such a nice exciting conference.
And today I'm talking about the nano or material science stuff, and especially putting the emphasis on supercomputing facilities available in my institute. Actually, in my group, I have two students from Thailand Governmental Institute, one from Defense Technology and one from NECTEC, also which is one of the organizers of the present conference. And especially the awning, Onishi Hagran, introduced me a quite interesting food available in Chiang Mai, so I was looking forward to visit here. After the conference, I will enjoy these kind of dishes, especially the alive shrimp is quite interesting. Anyway, let me introduce where coming from, I'm coming from. That is the GIST, one of the research institute and the university in Japan, which is opposite from Tokyo side, quite snowy, but so the students from Thailand are actually enjoying the much snow there. And the GIST is one of the governmental institutes which have only 900 students, quite the faculty's number is 300, so the larger cost performance for students. And more than 40% of the students are coming from foreign countries, so the campus are very international stuff. And promoting those from different field backgrounds. So also my two Thailand students, not coming from physics-based or chemistry-based, but now enjoy learning such a nanotechnology stuff. And GIST is also very famous for its supercomputers. I will talk about this later. So this is one of the attraction of the present topics. So this is my self-introduction. And the strong message here is that I got the PhD in the models theory, not the ab initio theory. So after getting the PhD, I changed my field to the ab initio calculation. So I was also the external of ab initio field. So we can share some idea that what is the concept of ab initio. That is quite different from the conventional simulation research. So this is the plan of the talk. I start from, again, the concept of the ab initio studies is one of the important message of the present talk. But before that, I will talk about how exciting now in my research field. This is the keynote speech. So rather than on my personal research topics, but the wider review of what is the research in my research field is presented in the present talk. And then I will introduce what is our group interest, and then introduce you to the topics on high performance computing. So let's start from the overview. How exciting now, especially just recent 5 years, the situation has rapidly changed in my field. So basically, the topics here, ab initio simulation, is anyway quite fundamental, starting from the quantum mechanics fundamental equation. So what is the simulation is that solving the fundamental equation of the quantum mechanics. That is quite too far from the industrial application or maybe the defense technology, but recently, the situation has been changed. It used to be the tool for just a tool for the quantum many body physics. So application is just for basic case. It used to, but in this decade, the black box tool is well distributed packet. So many users are now running even on a tiny laptop PC. So rapidly becoming a common tool in the industry. So used to be when I was a PhD or student or the postdoc, this kind of diagram is quite far from the industrial part. But now, actually, the industrial engineers are actually playing with this kind of theory. So once the theory has been developed, then it is quite easy to learn already constructed theory. So now, how to learn the quantum theory is also changing. Not by reading the book, but by opening your input file working on your PC. So this is the shift of the relevant community. So the relevant community is that used to be the condensed matter physics people or quantum chemistry people, but now most of the user of this theory is not the physics or chemistry, but the material science or bioscience or some medical science. They use this as a tool. So the target also shifts to more practical stuff. So the strengths of the material, for example, strengths of the steels or some degradation of steels or the corrosion, more important technology in practical usage becomes the main target of our field, rather than the boring hydrogen molecules or silicon particles. And what is remarkable in a recent movement is that ab initio technique is now start to be coupled with computational thermodynamics, which is much more wider impact. So it used to be the ab initio calculation is just for the zero temperature stuff. That is actually useless for the application. Because in a practical sense, the target is in the finite temperature and the more dynamic. But once the ab initio technique is coupled with thermodynamics, then it becomes more practical. Now, the ab initio technique is regarded not a tool for the ground state energy, but a tool to evaluate the entropy part of the whole Gibbs energy. So, based on such things, now it is a big chance for newcomers. Used to be there's already the big traditional group there in Japan or United States. So the newcomer has the disadvantage. But now the situation is so rapidly changes. So the frameworks are almost saturated. The advantage for the traditional theoretician becomes rusty. Because they tend to stay within the many body theory. They are not so interested in application. So the newcomer are much more aggressive for new applications. So that is a big chance. And so based on such background, so many new Asian newcomers are joining. And ab initio research don't require the huge facilities. Every group can start with a tiny laptop, laptop PC. And then eventually larger. So this is one of the advantage of our research field for newcomers to start research. So that is the first part, the overview how how exciting the recent change in my view. Then I will start talk about the concept of ab initio research. Ab initio simulation is, as I explained, just working on the most fundamental equation, not the empirical model, but the most fundamental equation is the target of the simulation. So, materials properties are finally dominated by electrons. So the idea is that the fundamental equation to describe the electron is already clarified around 100 years ago. So everything is included in this one equation. So just solving this equation, then every electronic properties can be reproduced and can be predicted. That is the ab initio idea. But there are still many researchers who don't like this idea. This is just like this thing. If you want to start up the research of the human society, and every human being, its genome, is already clarified. So everything is started from genome. So the researching the genome can describe the human society. But most of the people disagree with such idea. Okay. So the modeling is quite important. So this is a little bit stupid. But ab initio simulation is quite similar to like such idea. So still there are so many big professors. I don't like the ab initio method. But actually the ab initio research field is getting growing and growing. So the contrast is the empirical simulation and the ab initio. And the idea and what is important is quite different from each other. In empirical simulation, the important concept is how to set up the model and how to choose the parameters. That is the important point for the empirical conventional simulation. So the researcher should pay most attention to constructing a good model. Thank you very much. Good model to the model so that it is that. But in ab initio simulation, there is no model construction. No need to set up the model. The target is only this. Okay. So what the researchers have to pay attention is to make relation between the target quantity and the output of the simulation. Actually, in the empirical simulation, output of the simulation, simulating variables is the quantities which is directly interested, like electromagnetic field or displacement or the flow speed or whatever. But in ab initio simulation, the output quantity is the wave function. What is a wave function? Wave function relates to what in the industrial interest. Output of the simulation is just the wave function and energy. So the most important point is how to connect these quite abstract quantity to your interest. So I put the name about this as a science of nanomodeling. Anyway, in the material simulation, the empirical simulation is mainly used for the continuum level and the molecular dynamics or whatever. But at the electron level, as well as the model theory, but ab initio simulation is today as one of the research fields. And as I explained before, I got the PhD in the model of delivery, but after that, I said, ab initio framework. So now, why the ab initio approach getting the attract is because of the relation between the data science. I will explain this later. Anyway, in the empirical simulations, the model is tailor-made for each research field. So, for example, the electronic engineering, there is an expert on the such models. And in the medical science, there is some expert on such research field that used to be. But once it is described from ab initio manner, everything is done in a universal view. So now the ab initio is starting destroying the barriers between these research fields. Because almost all the material science are dominated by electrons, and electrons is described by ab initio research. So the ab initio research is quite good affinity to the data science. If the tailor-made modeling is used, that is not so running on the recently developed data science. But the ab initio science is quite universal. So universal tool is very easy to be operated by the recent data science. So now, every kind of material, microscopic structures are operated by the automated structure searching, which is driven by the recent data science or the information science. That is quite rapidly growing. Then I will explain an example of what is the nanomodeling. That is quite tricky, but quite interesting. This is a problem which is introduced by my collaborating company, which fabricating semiconductor devices. And there, the devices are put on the substrate by solder. But so many times the solder has a void. That is cracking. So this is not so good to control the quality of the product. But this is quite far from our zero temperature ab initio simulation. So how do we cope with this kind of things? How to treat this by ab initio simulation? Ab initio simulation gives you only the zero temperature energy. But cracking is quite dynamic. But there is some. It is well known that such cracking is generated by the significant difference in the ionic diffusion velocity from upward to upward or downward. If such an imbalance, then such imbalanced velocity pushed up the interface to make up. Open up the cracking. So once we notice this, then there is a way to treat this kind of thing by the energy evaluation. Nanomodeling is like this. So this is the P is a property under the practical interest. For example, in this case, the how to suppress the boiling solder. And of course, this problem is too far from the ab initio simulation, which only evaluate the zero temperature ground state starting point. But we make the step-by-step approach. Quantity A dominating the target property B. In this case, the ionic diffusion velocity is corresponding to A. So if we can evaluate quantity A, then we can somehow try working on program P. But quantity A, ionic diffusion is still far from the zero temperature ground state energy. But if we look at the materials theory, then the ionic diffusion velocity is dominated by the energy barrier when the ions move. So if the energy barrier is high, then the velocity is low. And and vice versa. And energy barrier can be described and evaluated by ab initio calculation. So by using ab initio calculation, we evaluated this one, and taking the material theory, we can estimate this one, and then make discussion about the problems. So the step-by-step approach is possible. So this is a non-model. So what the researchers or engineers have to most attention is this connection. So this connection is thought by the brain of the researcher. So this is the summary that for practical industrial application, there is some nanomodeling is required to make relation between the zero temperature quantity to a practical properties, such as the rate or the toughness how it is weaker against the corrosion or whatever. So how to design the projection from the practical to combination is very important. This is called as modern, and this is sort of the modern science. So from such movement, the motif in our academic field has been changed quite recently. Before that, all the researchers in the ab initio field are just interested in how to construct the methodology, or how to make challenge for the fundamental unsolved problem on the quantum many body problem. But recently, the interest of our research field shift to modeling science, how to analyze a practical problem in our ab initio framework, because the methodology has already well developed and the situation has been already saturated. So I found that there are several different approaches for such modeling. This is sort of the step-by-step approach for nanomodeling. Only as a multi-mapping approaches. There are two more different approaches for the nanomodeling. One is a higher charge approach, and the second one is the correlation mapping approach. What is the higher charge approach? This is much more abstract stuff. So there are several layers of the simulation from empirical to even at the ab initio modeling, the DFT approaches as well as the more serious approaches. So more serious approaches, not depending on the empirical parameter, provides the parameters to upload. The serious method will provide the sort of the modeling function for the DFT approach, and the DFT approach provides much more macroscopic parameters, and then more macroscopic or the practical stuff is tackled by simulation. This is one of the nanomodeling form. Another form is that this is the example. Actually, I'm working also on this kind. Obviously, the molecular dynamics is quite important for the practical applications as well as computational stuff. But for these simulations, some empirical parameters required. And such empirical parameters are now possible to be provided by ab initio calculation by evaluating the formation energy, specific heat or mixing energy. So this is just in these 5 years or 10 years, it becomes possible. Another approach, I explained the higher charge approach. The another approach is just make the correlation mapping. It is for ab initio calculation, it is not possible to treat these more practical things directly. For example, the most interesting thing in the practical viewpoint is wettability or thermal efficiency or plastic deformation or whatever. That is too far from our ab initio calculation. But if we make some reasonable plot, we can make some relation. Like, for example, the wettability. Wettability has a large correlation between the dielectric constants. And this quantity can be evaluated by ab initio calculation. And once we can make such plot, then we can make some prediction by extrapolating this relation. So this is another way to go for the practical. So that is the concept of the ab initio research and what is the nanomodeling. That is the most important part of our research activity. So I will show several, couple of several examples of such applications in a wider. So, the summarizing of what I said so far is the stream upward to the practical application. And now the several route has been constructed quite recently. So this is one of the examples that for the wettability. Wettability is very important quantity. In our case, one of the research groups is now developing to how to fabricate the nano devices, not by the solid processes, but by the liquid processes, not using vacuum environment. Silicon, semiconductor is prepared in the form of the ink. And ink is pasted on the substrate and then baked to become the devices. But if this ink has the larger contacting angle, then it is not possible to make paint. So the wettability is very important in every aspect in the industry. And so the quantity to describe the wettability is this contact angle. If the contact angle is large, then the liquid never paint. So the lower angle is required. And nowadays, such contact angle is possible to be evaluated by molecular dynamics, not the ab initio approach, but the more empirical microscopic approaches. The molecular dynamics. But in order to do such molecular dynamics, then the force field, that is one of the empirical parameters required. And such force field is described as this kind of empirical potential. But how to evaluate these parameters? Then the ab initio simulation is required. We did quite serious ab initio calculation to describe the binding curve. And its asymptotic behavior gives the parameters C6 and C15. And once such parameters have been provided, then this kind of simulation can be done to cope with this capability. This is one of the examples of the layered approach. Another thing is the sublands. I explained how the ab initio stuff relates to the molecular dynamics. Then, how relates to the computational thermodynamics? So, as I explained before, the ab initio tool is now regarded to be a tool to evaluate enthalpy in a more wider sense. That is, thermodynamic free energy. And once the Gibbs energy has been obtained, we can use it in so many purposes. That is, for example, to describe the phase stability, or the phase diagram, or even to transport. So, point is that once Gibbs energy is evaluated, there are so many futures. Then the question is how to set up the theoretical Gibbs energy. Traditionally, it is just a model, mathematical model, that is written in a textbook, in a special case. But say from 1980s or 1970s, there are some interesting movement from methodology science that specific heat experiments is possible to give such a deep energy. That is called as Carlsbad framework. And quite recently, ab initio calculation can be used to construct this deep energy by evaluating this mechanism. But once the specific heat is obtained, then we can evaluate this essential for the computational thermodynamics. But now, the specific heat is a quantity which can be accessed by ab initio technology. So the research field is getting more exciting. So by using such framework, the phase diagram is evaluated. Phase diagram used to be traditionally only the topics for the student of the metallurgy science. But nowadays, ab initio people are quite keen with this kind of things. And actually, my research group is working on such phase diagram prediction for the strong magnets, that is neodymium. These kind of three component phase diagram is now the target of the initio calculation. So the steel industry is one of the quite attractive research targets for us. So in order to make this more strong steel, the controlling the tissue. The size of the tissue is one of the most important things. And the size of the tissue is actually dominated by the surface energy, which is possible to be evaluated by ab initio. So now even the steel science and the steel industry engineers are now working on the ab initio calculation. So further futures includes especially the solubility and the precipitations and the batteries and the corrosion is also very important, especially for the different size or whatever. So if we evaluate the formation energy of oxygen, it can somehow describe how easy to be oxidized. That is a sort of corrosion. So this is the example how the ab initio comes with this. servants. And here I say that, I said that ab initio is regarded as a tool to evaluate the entropy part. But what about the entropy part? That is a cutting edge in, topics in our research. How to evaluate the entropy part. And since I'm not so expert on that, just I show the keyword. The cluster expansion method or cluster variational method is the tool to evaluate rather the entropy part than entropy especially the entropy coming from the several possible atomic configurations. Such thing is also one of the cutting edge topics. Just to skip this thing. As well as the new approaches, but the conventional approach is also still there. The conventional approach is just to use the ab initio to evaluate the energy and the charge density. But the energy evaluation and charge density evaluation is also somehow used. For example, the microscopic, microscopic structure of the molecules or the solid is described as the minimum point of the energy with respect to the structure. Okay. So the energy evaluation seems quite boring, but anyway, important. And once such energy minimum structure has been obtained, then we can estimate the reaction path for the chemical reactions. That is one of the traditional topics in quantum chemistry. And molecular recognition is now microscopically understood as the structure of the charge density. So the complementary distribution is act as a drug or some detector of such a chemical compound. So that definitely related to the drug design science. Especially, this is not ab initio, but the famous drug attacking to the virus, acyclovir, is just mocking the similar charge density to cheat the virus. So evaluating the charge density by using ab initio is quite useful in this sense. And the catalyst design is also dominated by how the charge density has been modified when the molecules are approaching the substrate. But this is one of the examples of the industrial collaboration there. We try to design the more better electrode which has more strength against the peaking. And the peaking can be described as the energy difference of the coupled compound and each divided compound. So the boring energy evaluation can be somehow useful. So I explained several example topics of the nano model. Then, in order to attract your attention to other feature, I will explain the choice of the simulation engine. So far, I just described it ab initio to ab initio, but there are several choices for the ab initio engine. That is called the DFT or DMC. And there are many representative researchers in Thailand as well about the DFT or molecular orbital theory. But the DMC is one of the attractions of my research. So, anyway, several possible simulation is anyway originate from single point calculation. So just like the every kind of dishes can be made by the single cooker. So I mean concentrated on the choice of the dish. So the major engines include molecular order method, that is an MO method, which is mainly has been developed by the quantum chemistry community. So you can find many researchers if you look at the chemistry department, molecular order method. And the density functional method is now the most powerful method for average. And my research group can cover all these three, including the DMC technique, which is much more new technology. Anyway, these three methods are stem from the same problem. All these things solve this fundamental equation by using a different manner. And in Monte Carlo simulation, uses a many body picture, not the one body picture. So the choices scatters around how expensive, and how reliable, and how practical, how tractable. But instead of that, but reliable method is expensive, whereas tractable things can run quite rapidly. And the main difference is to take if the one body picture or many body picture. Anyway, why reliability is so important, which is just decently regarded, is because of the coupling with data science. If data science is coupled to use the ab initio, then everything is automatic. So we don't monitor it, just the data science. So the more reliable prediction is required. So now more attention prediction reliability. The DMC has the largest reliability, whereas the DSP and MO is located around here. And another important factor is the feasible system size. The molecular order method is known as a quite serious reliable method, but it can be applied only to a tiny system because of the computational cost scaling with the system size. The molecular order method costs power 7 of the system size. So it is not possible to be applied to the solid state or the extended state system. But nowadays, DMC method can be possible to use even for the periodic system. So historically, the periodic system is the target of the physicists, but there is now disappearing the barrier between chemistry and physics. So the contemporary ab initio researchers have to cover the molecular science as well as the solid state. So what the QMC do is just work as a post-processor to brush up the prediction. So if the prediction by conventional molecular order or DFT is unreliable, unsatisfactory, then the QMC is used to brush it up more. So I will skip detailed stuff, but anyway, by using DFT, the conventional method, then the prediction is not so good, the poor prediction, but by using such a post-processing, then the prediction gets more closer to the expected amount. So this is one of the important things. And such collaboration is done mainly by the Asian countries. And the excitation energy is intermolecular forces, which is very important for the biochemistry. And the surface thing, interface thing, defect thing, that is an important quantity in device technologies, and the magnetism as well. Not well described by conventional ab initio, but nowadays DMC technology can be used to make more improvement on these things. So these are all our group interest. Of course, we are still working on a many body problem, fundamental problem, but biological things and the surface device things and the whole information science things are the group interest. So this is the example of the DNA binding. And the DNA binding cannot be well be described by the conventional approach, but the DNA can do that. So let me skip this. So our group can cover the most deepest layer into the more practical area, so this is my interest to include all of the states. Multi-layer approach. So now the methodology becomes enough saturated to be well developed. So no sticking specific method, but take care of the every area of the for the practice. We can handle even from DMC, so we are enough confident about the choice of the quite fundamental things. So this is an advantage. I will skip why the QMC is much more reliable than the initial thing, because the reason for skipping it is because this is the more general audience. But in short, solving the differential equation is replaced by the numerical minimization framework. And in the numerical minimization framework, there is less approximations required. So this is the quick reason why the method is much more reliable. Solving differential equation can be interpreted as the minimizing the function. So we take this viewpoint. And once the target quantity is written in terms of the integral, then the such integral can be implemented as a Monte Carlo sampling technique. And Monte Carlo, based on the law of the large number. And you know, the Monte Carlo technique is quite easy to be implemented as a parallel computation. This is how the connection to the high performance computing. It is costly, but actually that is cheap because of the quite high parallel efficiency. Because on each processor, the sampling is performed independently without any communication. So we use the K supercomputer as well for the massively large parallel calculation. This is the panel to show how our application is well parallelized. And I will explain how to read this panel. So if you use, for example, 20 cores, and then if you get the 20 times faster evaluation, that is perfect, right? So I could add ideal line like that. But usually, every practical application is not like ideal line, but since saturating, say around 20 or 10 or whatever. But in our Monte Carlo approaches, that is almost linear. So that means that if we use 5,300,000 cores, then we get the 530,000 times faster this panel means. That is quite exciting. And there is quite little application which gives such a linear mechanism. So sampling based methods are actually cheaper. So this is quite instructive for us. Traditionally, the physics or engineering are described by the differential equation, which is much more easier to understand. The differential equation is a sort of the common language of the scientists, right? So, clear, it gives a clear vision, but poor being parallelized. And once the differential equation is written in the variational form, then variational form is easily implemented by the Monte Carlo sampling, for which the parallelization is quite easy, and we can enjoy quite high efficiency. So depending on the availability of the computational framework, then the use frequently used framework also changes. This is the best, one of the best ones. The finite element method is one of such so even in our quantum Monte Carlo, it is not so straightforward to get such a linear efficiency. But in order to get the linear efficiency, so many analysis and more effort are required. This forms a new science field, that is the load balance science in a high performance computing field. Now I come to the last part, that is the parallel HPC things. The question is actually where high performance computing matters required. Because in order to understand that, starting from why supercomputers are so expensive, this is because the luxury internal communication switch costs much. But as I explained, the costly DMC simulation don't rely on such internal communication. So the luxury switch is not required. And for DFT or MO, actually that is not so parallelized. And recently, the one CPU includes 10 computational cores, so no need to purchase such a huge parallel computer. So where the large HPC is required? Actually, that is a large simulation in which the large memory capacity is required. So now the problem, what matters is not the CPU, but the memory capacity in a practical situation. So, you know, for these things, the 100 cluster is enough. So, in my group, we also fabricate the 100 cluster by ours, actually by myself, not by students, and making up such a kind of 100 cluster, which works quite well. And sometimes I construct such a thing in abroad to make up my satellite there. So the fastest high performance computing is where? Anyway, you have to remember that the batch queue system. So if you use the high performance computing, you have to wait in a queue. And it takes sometimes 3 days you have to wait. So then the K computer is the world fastest supercomputer it used to be. And in Japan, the fastest computer is the K supercomputer. But in practice, the K is not so high speed because we have to wait 3 days. So the Geist HPC is in this sense the most fastest computer because once I submit a job, immediately. So the Geist is not only for the Jaisu, but also other famous big university has the supercomputers. But remember that in usual university, every 6 years, the supercomputer is replaced, and they own the huge two kinds of supercomputer. But the Jaisu has four machines, and they replaced every 4 years. That is asked by law, Japanese law, governmental law. So every year we introduce new supercomputer. And considering the tiny number of the students, the queue is almost dangerous. So this is the reason why the Jaisu supercomputer is actually fastest. So very crowded, for example, the Tokyo University supercomputer I use. Maybe have to wait 1 day or 2 days, whatever. And by using such our computational facility, I developed a quite international collaboration working on nano science simulation, because such a initial calculation, no need to stick on the laboratory equipment. You can use our supercomputer even from Kenya or even from Indonesia by remote things. And every communication by chatting on the Skype. This is what I'm doing international research. So thank you for your attention. That's all.
So, very interesting topics. And would like to welcome maybe one or two questions.
But I'm not. as I extend on my knowledge.
Thank you very much. One more question. Okay, then I'm going to ask you, because I'm half of the professor of Ramada.
Thank you very much for a great, interesting talk. You emphasize that your initial approach very much goes well with data science and compatible. But that is, as I understand, is for natural science where you know the very basic understanding of the fundamental mechanism.
Yes.
But for other domain like social science, human behavior depends on his belief, personal belief, or religion or culture, which is very much difficult to understand. We don't have a Schrödinger atmosphere equation for human intelligence. And even so, data science can help, because data science, everything we observe is a source. So I still have some problem understanding that data science and our initial approach. Yeah, that's one thing. And another thing is in your approach, you emphasize that starting from the very bottom is always good. But for example, we have invented a very nice concept like a temperature or pressure, okay, which is an intermediate concept. For example, pressure is the average force of the molecule moving around. And once we arrived at this intermediate concept, we can start building a model from that point. We don't have to go back each time to the very basic notion. So I was just wondering, if there are any sort of intermediate level equation which you can think fundamental, and you don't have to go back to it every time to the very bottom.
So from the last part, I show some panel that explain the connection between the computational thermodynamics and our issue. I mean, in that panel, there is some Hahn-Hilliard equation. That is sort of the intermediate fundamental equation at the thermodynamic level. From the Gibbs energy, it can describe the, how the transport is dominated or whatever. So that is the last part of the question. And the first part of the question, I've shown some panel that describe the correlation mapping approach. So in a practical situation, there are so many uncertainty, like psychological stuff or some thing. That is all included in the correlation mapping. The fundamental predictable by simulation is taken as the horizontal axis and observable things. And what is important is the observed fact, right? So, and then the prediction is the matter of the data science. So taking many data science as an observer fact and then make some prediction, and somehow we can make it. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, now I'd like to invite our chairman to present a token of appreciation for our keynote speaker.
Thank you. Great testing. And now I would like to invite our honorary guests and invite the speakers on the stage for a group photo, please.